super excited to be here. I love writing conferences. I've been attending them for years and years and years. And even though I was just telling my daughter, it makes me incredibly nervous every time I present, I actually really love to present as well. I feel like I learn a lot while preparing presentations, while giving them. I love the idea of being able to kind of give back and teach people some things I've learned along the way. So just for my curiosity, how many of you, this is your first writing conference? Welcome to the dark side. you will soon be addicted and you will do this way more often than is probably advisable. One of the things I love about writing conferences, not only do we gain a lot of information, but we begin to realize there are other people that are super weird in the same way we are super weird. And it's reassuring. Writing is, by its very nature, an isolated undertaking. We do it alone in front of a computer. And it's easy for us to feel like we're alone in this endeavor, like we're the only ones that struggle with the things we struggle with, and we're the only ones who hit the same roadblocks. But when we go to conferences like this, we recognize that that's not the case. Plus, it helps force us back into socializing and the real world, and that's probably not a bad thing. I'm excited to start us out today. I love that we have new people here who are new to conferences, some of who are more veterans. I hope that this will be a useful bit of information for all of you. I'm going to be talking today about the building blocks of plot and character. And because they're the building blocks, we're going down to the basics, the things that we build upon, the foundation of plots and characters. Now, some of you who've been writing for a while might be thinking this probably isn't going to be useful. I promise you it will be. One of the wonderful things about conferences, again, is the reminder of the most basic principles of writing that help keep us on track and help solidify the foundation we're building on. Plus, anytime someone presents a topic to you, they're gonna have a slightly different take on it than the last person who presented it, and a slightly different take on it than you might already have. And it opens up new possibilities. It's easy, especially as an established writer, to kind of get into a rut where we're stuck on doing things the way we've always done them. And we don't realize it, but that shows in our writing. Our writing starts to get formulaic and starts to get predictable and boring. And we don't take the risks we ought to be taking. So, even if you feel like this is a topic you know, I promise you're gonna learn something new. If nothing else, you're gonna learn that I'm kind of goofy and shouldn't be taken very seriously. Okay, no, actually, I should listen close. All right, so, undermining my own presentation. I have, hiding like a creepo in the corner, here my daughter. I joke that I had children just so they would carry my books to signings and events, and it's finally paying off, guys. So that's why she's here. She's hiding back then. That probably embarrassed her, so I'm sorry. but she's there. She's helping out. So we're going to get going. I always start out my presentations with a disclaimer. In writing, we like to talk a lot about rules. There are rules. You have to do something this way. You have to prepare to write this way. You have to organize your writing time this way. We have lots of rules. And it took me a long time to figure out, people waving from the hallway. Guys, I get distracted really, really easily. So feel free to be like, back on topic, Sarah. Okay, we talk about rules. And for a long time, that would get frustrating to me because I would hear, only ever do this. And it just didn't click in my brain. And I'd think, why? I don't understand why. And because I'm incredibly stubborn, I'd be like, fine, I'm not gonna do it that way, just because you told me I had to. What I didn't understand was what we refer to often as rules are really foundational principles. They're principles of writing that if you understand them, you can build on them and use them in the ways that work for you. I've heard it said, learn the rules like a pro so you can break them like an artist. And that's what we're talking about, is those principles, those rules. So my disclaimer is, I'm going to show you some ways to apply the principles I'm talking about today. I'm going to show you some methods, some approaches, and we're going to practice them so you have lots of experience. Take them home with you and try them out. And if this approach doesn't work for you, switch it up a little. Try tweaking it, doing a little bit different until you find what works for you. Every author is unique. Every author's needs are different. The way things click in one author's brain is not the same as another. And I found as an author, over time, what once worked for me doesn't work anymore. I think it's that idea of our brain almost hits autopilot, and because we're doing things the same way, and so we don't look at things creatively and from a different angle. So even if you've been doing this for a long time, try changing up your approach, your routine. So that basically is me saying, don't listen to anything I'm saying, but listen to what I'm saying. So you guys work out that contradiction on your own. Okay, so we're talking today about building blocks of plot and character. Now, those of you who attended Storymakers last year, that's a big conference held down in Utah County in May, may have attended. I taught a 2-hour intensive class just on characterization. So there is no way I can cover all of plot and all of character in 1 hour, and that's okay, because we're talking about building blocks, we're talking about foundation. It's not going to be nearly as intense as that. I warn people, your brain will ooze out of your ears by the time you leave, and I saw it happen, so it's not going to be as intense as that. We're going to give you some basics. But I put the two together because, to me, plot and character are intertwined. They can't really be separated. If your plot could happen independent of your characters, then you don't have a story. If your characters could exist and make decisions that had no impact whatsoever on the plot, you don't have a story. The two are connected, and they have to be. So that's why we're going to be talking about both. And I have found, and we're going to talk about this here, I'm going to show you my approach to it, but you guys, again, adapt it to fit what works for you. I have found that when I'm working on my plot and my characters, if I do it side by side, if I do them together, I'm more likely to find how they interweave and how they interconnect, and I'm more likely to find when they don't, because that can be a problem. And if you don't realize that until you're halfway through your draft, then you get to start over, and because I just had to do that yesterday, but I don't recommend it, so there you go. Okay, and the two are going to influence each other. What happens in your plot will be influenced by your characters, and what happens, how your characters respond to what happens in your plot is going to be dependent upon that. So what is one of the questions that authors get asked most often by people curious about the writing life? For me, it's where do you get your ideas? You guys heard that before or asked that question? For a long time, I wasn't sure how to answer it, because to me, ideas are a dime a dozen. I have a million of them. But it occurred to me that what was really being asked was, where do you get your stories? And to me, I've always separated the two. So that's the first thing I'm going to talk about, is what I think of as ideas. And to me, they're more story seeds. They're that little tiny itty-bitty beginning. And chances are, even if you feel like, oh, I don't have a lot of ideas, you probably actually do. You're just dismissing them because they're small. So that's what we're going to talk about first, is idea seeds. So I'm going to put that up here. So when you find out how short I am, guys, I'm short. Seriously. One of my goals was to have a 5 somewhere in my height number, and it didn't happen. So that gives you an idea. All right. Okay. Okay, so your ideas are your story seeds. They're small, they're tiny, they're unexplored. I have in my purse, I carry around all the time, a little notebook that's just idea seeds. Anytime something pops into my mind, I write it down. Maybe something I heard about on the news, maybe a conversation I accidentally overheard in line at the grocery store. Maybe it's something my children did that I thought, I'm going to write about that because it will be cathartic as a mother. Yeah. Those are your idea seeds. They're tiny. They're little ideas. They start out small. I'm going to switch to a different marker because this one is a little light. So, for example, watching the movie Finding Nemo, there's this line when the fish are at the shark intervention meeting. And one of the sharks says about the other, he never even knew his father, right? It's a great line, but that's also a great story seed, right? If you have a character who never knew his father. Now, is that a whole story unto itself? No, but it's an idea, and it's something you can start from. Okay, and then another one, I read obituaries, guys. I'm a weird person. I also hang out in cemeteries. I shouldn't be making these confessions to you, but I do. I went to dinner at a friend's house the other day. She lives across the street from the cemetery, and I just like stared out her window at the cemetery for long, drawn-out minutes, and she was like, thanks for coming. That's just me. I'm fascinated by odd things. And that's why we're here, right? So we can all be fascinated together. Even if you don't like cemeteries, pretend like you do. It'll make me feel better. Okay, so I like to read obituaries. I know that's weird. But to me, it's the summation of a person's life, yes. And to me, I find that fascinating. And one that I came across a while back is what they had written about this person was that she had changed so many lives but never felt like her life mattered. And it's both tragic and, for an author, really, really intriguing. I'm sick, guys. Okay, so... So someone, there's lots of nevers in there. Apparently I'm a very optimistic writer, man. So never made a difference, right? So that's a story idea. And whether or not you write that as a tragedy or a comedy or the ghost comes back to just to make a difference in the life that they once lived. Lots of different things that can go on. What other little story ideas can you think of? Maybe things you've come across lately. Anyone have one they want to throw up? Oh, P.S. My classes are always interactive. I don't know if anyone warned you. You will be forced to communicate.
There was an ad. Some guy had been on an airplane and he was looking for the woman who had sat next to him.
Perfect. And now my romance brain is going, okay, where was she going? Why was he so intrigued? What happened? Okay, copyright Sarah Eden. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, so met on airplane, and I'm just going to put an ad. So we'll remember, right, guys? Okay, Lisa in the back.
I saw a wedding announcement in the paper that concluded with the line, all good fairies invited.
Nice. Okay, who has another one? All right, what's your idea?
I had an idea based on the idea of magic that could be played with, like strings that you could mess around with and undo.
Okay, awesome. I'm gonna put string magic, we'll remember. I have a lot of faith in your guys' memory, apparently, so live up to it, no pressure. Okay, string magic. So again, it's a story seed, right? It's not the whole idea, but it's somewhere to start. I'm going to grab one more from you guys.
There was a really brief shootout in front of my house the other day. It was really scary. They shot through my front window. It was terrifying. But it was a story idea because it was like, I was like, why were they doing that? What was going on? What were the motivations between these two people to shoot at each other in the middle of the day? Like, it just got my brain going.
Like I said, writers are sick people. Okay, shoot out in your front yard. Your first thought is, I wonder what their motivation is. Someone tell me the backstory. You walk out there, please tell me, where did you grow up? And what led you to this moment in your life? The ultimate negotiator, you make them tell you their life story. They're like, I will quit shooting if she will quit asking questions. Okay. And this is why when people ask where do you get your ideas, I try not to laugh because it's bad to laugh at people who are genuinely curious, but because we have so many ideas. We came up with a decent list of story seeds, just kind of throwing it out. It's just stuff we saw around us. It's just ideas that popped into our head. So you probably have a ton of ideas, but you may be discounting them because there's not a lot to them. Don't do that, because we build on story ideas. Seeds are where we get the trees, right? So don't discount them. If you are not writing down story ideas that you have, you're doing yourselves a tremendous disservice. Write them down. I also have on my computer a file where I keep them, because I lose notebooks, let's face it. Because writers are terribly organized people. But I transfer those ideas into this folder on my computer, and I open it up once in a while and just read through it. And there are a lot of ideas in there that are really terrible ideas, and I get that now. But they're there. And just reading through them again gets my brain spinning. So be writing down your story seeds. Even if you don't think there's much of a story there, write them down. I even write down really intriguing dreams that I have. You know, when you first wake up and you're convinced it's the next bestseller, but when you look back at it a couple days later, you're like, yeah, I have a lot of those. But write them down anyway. If nothing else, okay, Sarah's backdrop is in social science, statistical research, and behavioral theory. Yeah. That's a mouthful, right? Basically, I'm a nerd. So going back to those days, when you write down and keep the ideas that you have, it's a feedback loop, and it tells your brain that there's value in the ideas it comes up with. So by recording them and keeping them written down, your brain is more likely to come up with more. So give your brain positive feedback by holding on to the ideas it gives you, okay? And scene. No, just kidding. That's the end. No, it isn't. Okay, so that's where we start, is with seed ideas. This is your cornerstone, but the very first thing you lay in your foundation of plot and character is your basic seed, your basic story idea. And there are so many, and they come all the time. Now, not all seeds are going to become stories, because not all of them have enough to them. Or you may find that as you explore them, they don't interest you enough to keep going, and that's okay. Another thing that I have found that has been wonderful for all these many, many story ideas that I have is writing short fiction. If you aren't writing short fiction, you should try it. Even if you're not writing it to show to anybody, just as a writing exercise. Short fiction is not a full-length novel, it's a short story or a novella. It doesn't require as big of a story idea or plot. It's a great practice. So think about that. Short fiction is awesome. Yeah.
Sarah, just before you erase that, we'll want to photograph it because it's not coming through the video in the other room, unfortunately.
Sorry, other room. Okay. Now they won't, maybe they won't revolt. Okay. So write those down, work on them. Short fiction is awesome. How's that for? Okay, we're going to take a picture. Makes me wish my penmanship was a little bit better. All right, okay. So when you have, now that you have story ideas, the next thing that I tend to do, and again, you guys can switch this up. Deciding in different orders is okay. Sometimes things will change. Another thing you need to know about your story is your genre. Is everyone familiar with the term genre? Genre is the type of story that you're writing. For me, I write historical, and I write historical romance. So those are my genres. It's hard to write when you're like on your tiptoes, guys. Okay, so like for me, I do historical. So that's a genre. What are some other genres you guys write?
Fantasy.
Hey, fantasy.
Magical realism.
Magical realism, okay.
Thriller.
All right. Oh, I apparently don't know how to spell magical. That's a problem. Okay.
Dystopics.
Okay.
Suspense.
All right, I heard a Greg Luke voice. I often hear his voice in my mind, so let me know if he's actually here. I saw you. All right. And his voice usually comes from somewhere up here. All right. Okay, oh, dystopia. I missed that one. All right, does anyone write YA or middle grade? YA is young adult. Middle grade is going to be your like elementary age. That's a very, very broad definition of the two, but you got it. All right, YA, middle grade. So there are a whole bunch. Now, why do you think it'd be important for us to know what the genre is of the story we're writing?
So you can know your audience.
You know your audience, exactly. And does it change your story? If you're writing a middle grade, is that going to be written very, very differently than a historical romance? It probably should be, because it doesn't. There's not a lot of crossover between those two genres, I found, generally speaking. Yeah.
There's also certain expectations that come with different genres, and you don't want to necessarily disappoint your reader in those particular areas.
Absolutely. Genres come with particular expectations, and to a degree, certain promises. In romance, for example, there's a certain promise to the reader that not only will the romance be the main focus of the book, won't be the only thing going on, but it's the main focus, but there's also a promise that it has a happy ending. So if you don't know that, and you're writing romance, you're gonna have a lot of angry, I mean, romance readers wield pitchforks like nobody's business, so I wanna upset them. So you need to know, because that changes how you're writing, it changes what you're writing. Is it going to impact what your seed grows into? Absolutely. So you have to know. For some of you, you write a particular genre and that is just you. For me, it's historical and historical romance. I've tried to write contemporary, that's like modern day, and the feedback is always, these people talk like Mr. Darcy, and I'm like, I know, right? And I've tried writing books that didn't have romance in them, and by chapter two, they're always a romance. It's just who I am. And anyone who knows me personally is really shocked by that, because I'm not a romantic person. My husband finds it especially concerning, because he's just like, I don't even know who this is. Someone asked me once, why do you write romance? And I said, well, it's like my romantic outlet. And my husband says, couldn't I be your romantic outlet? And I told him it didn't work that way. So figure out who you are. Other people write in multiple different genres. Yeah, they have a knack for YA, they also have a knack for epic fantasy, and they enjoy writing general. So if you're one who writes in a few different genres, you're gonna have to decide what you're writing for this one. Now here's the thing, you might change your mind. I've had people tell me, well, I thought I was writing a dystopia, but by the end I realized it was a post-apocalyptic, which there's a slight difference between the two, but they figured it out. Or someone saying, I thought this was, you know, adult fantasy, and I realize now it needs to be YA. So these things can change, but knowing that is crucial. Yeah.
Don't you find there can be elements of several different genres in the same story?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Like if you're writing a thriller or a suspense, that doesn't mean you're not absolutely not going to have any romance in it whatsoever. You probably should, because that's what makes all writing good. I let you off the hook if you write middle grade, because that would get awkward. But yeah, absolutely. And you may find it's kind of a crossover. It has elements of some or elements of the other. This is part of figuring out what you're writing, because knowing what you're writing influences how your seed grows and how it develops. I'm getting super metaphorical here, guys. The Arbor Foundation would be super proud of me. It's talking so much about trees. Okay. So, I always have people practice. So, just so you know, I said interactive and full of practice. Feel free to be taking lots and lots of notes. At the very end, I'm hoping there's time I'm going to have you develop from beginning to end a full story plot idea. You're welcome. All right, so let's take one of these ideas. Let's just pick one. Who has one they want to run with?
The airplane one.
Okay, so this is the person took out an ad trying to find a woman he met on an airplane. I've never enjoyed anyone I sat next to on an airplane, so I have no, I'm just kidding, guys. Don't tell people that I'm not friendly. I'm not, but don't tell them that. I have this image. Okay, so two people met on an airplane. A guy takes out an ad to try and find her. So, which genre do you think? Now, we didn't write romance ever. I'm going to go ahead and write it, but that doesn't mean you have to pick it, okay? Okay, probably not historical, right? Sometimes the seed idea determines the genre to an extent. So I'm going to put romance. But you know what? I'm going to challenge you. How could you adapt that basic story seed to be a historical?
Steamboat.
What's that?
Like steamboat.
On a steamboat. Maybe they met on a steamboat. Right? What else?
Or you could do airlines earlier in the 20th century.
Okay. Very, very, very early on.
Don't have to be hundreds of years ago.
Right? Historicals are generally pre-World War II. But maybe you're not. Maybe not going full historical. You're just not going right this minute. Okay. What else could you do to make it work as a historical? Ooh. Okay, so you see why genre can change your story seed, but it's already starting to grow, right? Because now that we've decided it's a nurse on a troop ship, suddenly we have elements of plot there that were not part of the original seed, right? It's growing already. It's like we're watering it. Okay, so that changed. Let's do a different one. Pick a different idea.
You could do thriller.
Okay, so how would sat next to a woman on an airplane and takes out an ad to find her, and that's our basic story seed. How do you adapt it to be a thriller?
The guy found out that she was responsible for one of his family's
deaths. Okay, so he's got
to
track her down. There you go.
Or she's his next victim.
Oh, I both love and fear the way your mind works. That's awesome. That's also why I stay friendly with Greg Luke, because he could kill me in so many ways. Interesting. Maybe they're the only two survivors, and he's reaching out to her as part of maybe dealing through PTSD or that kind of thing. Back and forth. They have to figure out why the plane crashed. Okay.
Or maybe they think they survived, and they actually
didn't. Oh. Okay. Spoilers. You're going totally like lost on us here, right? that show's old. Okay. I shouldn't have to give a spoiler alert, guys. Okay, let's pick one more genre and try it out, because to me, this is the moment when the stories grow, is when I decide for sure. Now me, I always write historical, so for me it's determining which era and which location, because that changes stories. So bear that in mind too. Okay, let's pick one more genre to adapt our Met on an Airplane.
Fantasy.
Seed. Fantasy. Okay, how would you adapt that to be fantasy? See, now I don't know a lot about fantasy, I automatically think the giant eagles from Lord of the Rings. They were like,
hey. Go steampunk with it.
Go steampunk, absolutely. Uh-huh.
She's not human.
She's not human, interesting. Ooh, maybe he's the doctor. Okay, guys. That's less fantasy and more like fanfiction nerd out up here, okay? My daughter and I spent lunch yesterday discussing which Harry Potter house the different doctors would belong to, so that tells you a lot about our family. There was some roaring debate over that, so okay. We have problems. All right, so do you understand what we're talking about here? By knowing your genre, it changes your story. And sometimes the genre you assumed it would be doesn't create the most intriguing story. Sometimes you need to step out of it. If you're one who absolutely writes in a particular genre, think about the variations within that genre. Maybe you write romance, but think about it, is it historical, is it contemporary, is it paranormal, is it, I don't know, you figure it out, it's not my job, guys. Okay, so figuring that out helps you figure out what else is there. It helps you start building your story. Okay, all right, so we have our idea, we have our genre. What comes next? And again, this is the way I do it. You guys play with it when you get home. You may find doing it in a different order works for you. You may find focusing longer on one area than another works for you. And this is all, now I'm talking super nerd, it's backwards compatible, guys. You can go back and change as you come up with different ideas. So next we need our protagonist, or our main character. Who is this story about? And I'm probably spelling this wrong. Does that look right, guys, vaguely? Your silence is not reassuring. All right. You got the point. This is your main character. Who is this story about? Okay, and for me, I start with some basic information. Let's just create a protagonist here. Give me an age. Now again, this will be influenced by your genre. If you're writing YA, there are very specific age expectations. If you're writing middle grade, there are age expectations. If you're writing romance, your main characters need to be legal age, okay? So bear that in mind.
40.
Yeah. 40, is that what I heard?
Oh.
Okay, no, someone said something different. I hear things, have you noticed that?
40.
What's that?
40.
Let's go 40, okay. So if your character is 40, or at least 40-ish, right around there, chances are you're not writing middle grade. Chances are you're not writing YA. I shouldn't say chances are. You're not writing middle grade. And you are not writing YA. I told you there are some, the rules are meant to be broken. That's one that's not meant to be broken. I promise if you try to pitch a middle grade book to anyone with a 40-year-old protagonist, it's not going to work. Okay? All right. So, 40. What is their occupation? What do they do for a living? I heard pilot from behind the board. Okay, which, if you're writing this story,
yeah,
the pilot probably should have known who he was sitting beside on the airplane. Okay? But see, suddenly you're either writing, a comedy, or you're writing like a medical thriller where the pilot's been injected with like a forgetfulness serum and knows that only his co-pilot could possibly answer all the questions that he has, and he has to. So determining things like this about your character changes your story.
Why can't he be 40 years old with a dissociative psychosis that makes him think he's middle grade age?
I would read the daylights out of that book. Get on it, Greglick, get on it. Okay, so that, and I'm just gonna jump down here. That brings us down to what I call defining character traits. And I do lots of abbreviating because it makes it confusing. So that one of them could be that, where they things that change who they are or directly influence who they are. What's one of our defining character traits of this pilot?
He just thinks he's a pilot.
Justin thinks he's a pilot.
Oh.
And he's like, I need to know who was sitting beside me because I don't know how she landed the plane and I'd like to learn. All right, okay, so he is delusional. Okay, let's go back and try a different character. What's a different age? You can even be an age group. You could just say teenager. You could say elementary school. You could say,
it should be 18.
18, okay. Now I'm gonna toss this back to Lisa in the back. Would an 18-year-old be your lead character in a YA, do you think? To me, that kind of hits us new adult YA. I'm not sure where it hits.
It could be, it depends on what the problem is they're trying to solve.
Okay.
Because you could be 18 just out of high school,
mm-hmm,
and dealing with a certain kind of problem that would be a YA.
Uh-huh.
You could also be 18 just going into college.
And that kind of shifts you over.
Okay. That would straddle the line and move you into new adult.
But what if it's not contemporary?
It comes down to the type of problem they're dealing with, probably, I would imagine. I don't write this stuff, guys.
If it's not contemporary, like if it was fantasy, then for sure you can have YA fantasy at 18.
Okay.
And the rules, you know, you start...
Change up a little.
You start getting into sort of some of the, you know, the edges.
Right, right.
As long as you can convince me that it works, it works.
Awesome. And we're going to talk in a second about the problem that we're dealing with, because that also will kind of define it. So again, knowing your genre, knowing your age can influence what the problem is, and that's what we're getting to next.
Maybe the 18-year-old is a genius, so they're already through college.
Okay.
That would fit a lot of social issues.
Oh, absolutely. So you have genius right there.
and they're done with school, right? A hacker.
It's a futuristic universe.
Love it. Okay. So chances are, if they're 18 years old, finished with college, and they're a computer hacker, you are not writing a historical. Chances are. But yeah, it could be a futuristic, so it could be post-apocalyptic, it could be dystopian, it could be a thriller, it could just be future, you know, down the road. So there are a lot of different options there, but knowing these things changes it. Now, if you know you're writing a historical, what job could you give them that had a similar idea? Someone who infiltrates.
Codebreaker.
Right, so a codebreaker, like in the war. Or at my house, I'm just kidding. That's how my kids find out what's for dinner. I give it to them in code. If they solve it, they get to eat. Just kidding. She's like, no, she's not. Okay, so there's a few different ideas, right? And knowing those things builds on this. Let's pick one of these ideas. The one we haven't done yet. So we've done this one. What should we do next?
Fairy wedding invite.
Okay, so an invitation fairy. Inviting fairies. Oh, so chances are you're not doing a straightforward, realistic fiction, right?
Unless the main character is delusional and is inviting fairies to their wedding and they don't know they're...
And fairy is a code word. Right? And yet all these fairies show up thinking it was a real invitation. So, you know, so that was a story idea, right? Now, I do this when I sit down to write a new book or work on a new story. I go through a zillion, that's a number, right, guys? A zillion different versions, brainstorming and trying new things, changing up aspects of the story until I hit on the one that I'm super excited about. The one that I feel like I can get some more depth out of. Okay, so let's stick with the fairy wedding invite. And let's pick our 40-year-old. We still want him to be a pilot. Him, or I guess it could be her. I just keep saying him because before it was a him. All right, so do we still want him to be a pilot or should we come up with a different occupation?
Let's make her as a girl and she doesn't know because maybe she's newly divorced and she was a homemaker. So maybe it's like she doesn't know.
Okay, so she is in need of an occupation. She is unemployed? I don't know. That's not quite the right term, but I don't do words, guys. That's what editors are for. All right, so we have a 40-year-old who receives a wedding, and 40, the numbers kind of tells you what stage of life they're in. So it's not like, okay, she is 40, therefore. But it does tell you, if we did decide that she was recently divorced, you know, then you decide, does she have children? What ages are her children? So these are jumping off points. This is where you start and you build your characters from there. So she receives an invitation to a wedding that has invited fairies, and fairies apparently demand tremendous amounts of really, really expensive gifts, but she's unemployed. So what is she gonna do? Okay, so it kind of changes things up. Maybe she doesn't have a job, she doesn't have any money, but this is one of her like ex-boyfriend's weddings, and he has the gall to invite fairies when no fairies showed up to her wedding. So she's gonna show up and just show him what's what. So see, as you play around with it, it changes what your story is.
Or maybe since all good fairies are invited and she needs a job, maybe she's gonna figure out how she can get a job as a good fairy.
There you go, she brings her resume. She's like, I would be an excellent good fairy. And they're like, I don't know, you are 40. And she's like, I know the cutoff is 39. Let's make an exception. So, you can, in case you can't tell, most of my books turn into comedies. But play with it. And what you come up with isn't necessarily what you will end on, but it gets your brain thinking.
Maybe she goes thinking it was her ex that she used to be in love with. And the fairies actually do come. It wasn't just a play on words. And she eats the cake and they take her.
Okay, so she gets kidnapped. Awesome. Okay.
You eat their food, you're there. This is how it is.
And maybe one of her character traits is she gets kidnapped all the time. And she's like, not again. And she always gets kidnapped from eating cake, but she loves cake so much. Okay? So she launches this new diet program. You guys, this brain of mine doesn't do normal things. Okay, so came with these things. When I work out character, like I said, I taught a 2-hour class on determining aspects of character. We're not going to go over all of that right now. But I always figure out a basic age group. I figure out, what do they do? You know, are they a student? Are they self-employed? Do they have a job outside of the home? Do they work inside of the home? Depending on era, all that kind of stuff, it'll change what they do with their life. What are their defining character traits? What are their other things I make lists of? Are things like likes and dislikes? Like our lady who loves cake so much she gets kidnapped for it. Disliked? Wow. Okay, again, I don't do words. Okay, other things that I will put up here are strengths and weaknesses. One thing I will tell you, a common mistake I see, especially in new writers, is the feeling that you want your hero or your heroine to be perfect. And they shouldn't be, because no one is. So strengths, weaknesses, we're getting close to running out of time, guys. Okay, I'm gonna hurry up. Okay, our last column that I do, our very, very last section of it, and again, I'll go back and forth as I do this, changing things up, trying new combinations. The last one is goal or problem. You could look at it either way, because generally their goal is going to be to solve this problem, and their problem is trying to solve this goal that they will all have. Connected to that goal are obstacles, things that get in their way, things that prevent them from either realizing their goal or solving their problem. And I will get out of the way of the board in just a second. And then the last part of this section is consequences. It's like my brain jumps ahead a few letters. Okay, the consequences means basically what will happen if they fail, what will happen if they succeed. If they're, I keep moving like away from the camera. All right, if the goals that they have don't ever hit any obstacles, if nothing's getting in their way, you don't have a story, because your tension comes from goals meeting obstacles. If your goal or problem has no consequences, then it doesn't matter. And if it doesn't matter, then you don't have a story. So you have to figure out all of these things. And this is where I go to next. So let's look at some, let's look at our 18-year-old genius hacker. What goal might this character have?
Hijack the plane
where the guy met his soon-to-be future wife. We are just combining. But see, he never knew his father, so you can't blame him.
Okay. Maybe the man on the plane was his father.
Oh, and next to him was his mother. And they didn't know it. So it's a love story. It's a parent trap meets espionage, right?
And he's the pilot.
And he's the pilot. Everyone's like, why are you hijacking the plane? You're flying it. He's like, for the challenge. Okay. So his goal is to hijack the plane. What's getting in the way? We know he's a genius, especially at computers. So at least on some level, there will probably be, you would hope, some security measures in place. He probably can get around them, but is it still an obstacle? Yeah. Those are probably some of your earliest obstacles. That's another thing to bear in mind. The obstacles will grow as your story goes on. It has to get harder and harder and harder and harder. If it starts out hard and everything after that is easy, you've written it backwards. And your readers might have to read it backwards, and that just wouldn't work. Okay, so there's some security measures. What else might get in the way?
Weather.
Finding out his father's the pilot.
Oh, so suddenly he has, I'm twisting up, he has family on board. So now he's torn. Do I hijack the plane, because my goal was to bring it down, and kill my father, or do I save his life? Okay, so his own emotions, guys. Hot hackers can't have emotions. Okay, what else could get in the way?
He's delusional.
So he's not just a genius, he's delusional. Okay, so this is getting in the way.
He thinks there's aliens on it, and he thinks they have crazy tech that'll stop him from getting on. So he's preparing all this stuff.
He's imagining obstacles, and maybe he has to sort out what's real and what isn't. And maybe it's not that he's delusional, maybe this is actually a medical thriller, and he's got to bring this plane down like a hero while under the influence of something, right? So he's imagining obstacles. Okay, he's what?
Death.
He's dead? The voices from behind me. Can differing abilities or disabilities be an obstacle? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Can it also be a help? Yeah. Sure, can it be both at the same time? Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay, so differing abilities. So there are plenty of obstacles. Some of them are going to be situational, like weather and security, things that are in place that they have to overcome. Some of them are character driven, like this, obstacles that exist within your character. And they both need to be there. Because if your character is only coming up against obstacles they meet on the outside, then they're really being acted upon, and you want them to be acting. So give them things that are obstacles they're facing from within. In this case, you know, do I kill my father? No, it's generally not a good idea. Are these obstacles the ones I'm imagining? Which ones are real? Which ones are not real? I have to sort that through. Perhaps they have some sort of disability that they're overcoming. Okay, maybe one of his obstacles is he comes across code he can't break, and that's never happened. Ooh, so he's coming up against his own ego. My hubris was my downfall. That could be the title, guys. Copyright Sarah Eden. Okay, so what are the consequences of him? Let's try the consequences of success. Why, which is basically, why is he doing it? What happens as a result of him succeeding?
He's dead.
Maybe, is he on the plane? That becomes our next question. So if he's on the plane, then he will die. So you have to determine, why is it worth it to him? And now you're diving deeper into character motivation, and you need to know that.
Hijacking doesn't necessarily mean crashing the plane.
Okay.
He's taking it somewhere else. And maybe there's some disaster that's going to happen if the plane goes where it's supposed to go.
Okay, so, or maybe he's averting disaster.
Yeah, that's right. Or maybe it has the ransom from one country to another country that he's stealing the gold.
Okay, so he gets treasure beyond his wildest dreams. Okay, so what could be some potential consequences of failure?
Jail,
yeah. Right?
Well, or he could be blackmailed into the situation too. That's something I think about.
Okay. So perhaps if it's blackmail, then that means maybe someone he cares about
is gonna
die.
Yeah.
Maybe his dad's on the plane, but his mom isn't. Yeah. He's like, which parent do I love more? And suddenly it's an existential crisis. All right. Like I said, writers are sick. Okay, just accept it, guys. It's not going to change. Okay, what's another possible consequence of failure? His ego. He's going to feel bad, guys. And that would be sad. Okay, now, is feeling bad a big enough consequence of failure to drive a whole plot? No, of course not. But it's still a consequence. So something to bear in mind. Maybe this is what drives him early on, is he's just so full of his own importance that he's just like, there's no way I'm feeling at this. And as the story goes on and he begins pondering his relationship with his parents and discovering who he is inside and his bad life choices, then that starts to change. But writing all of this down and going through it helps you start to eliminate possibilities and focus in on what your story really is. Like at first we had started out with maybe he's on the plane so he's going to die, but he's willing to because it's some real big important thing. But what if it isn't the plane that's going to crash? Well, then what does that mean? And it helps you start asking the questions, what if? What if this was what was going on? What if my character was like this? What if the genre I'm supposed to be writing is this? What if? What if is a tremendously useful question for a writer, because usually your best story idea is not the first one you come up with. If you're like most writers, it's probably not the second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh. You will keep honing in and changing and adjusting. And that's not only okay, that's normal and it's good. Because if you always settle on your first story idea, you're missing some really great possibilities as you go. So this is what I do as I'm building the foundation of a plot and of characters that I'm working on. And I will change things as I go. If I think of something under obstacles that changes an aspect of my protagonist, I try changing that up. And if I change that, how does it change other things? Play around with it. This is useful to do before you even start, but it's also really useful to do if you've been working on a book and it stalls out. You can't figure out what comes next. Or you feel like it's just gone way off the tracks. How many of you have had and even if you haven't, raise your hand anyway, because it makes me feel better. I've written a book where you're partway through it and you think, this is not working. Yeah, like you can just tell that what you're doing isn't playing out right. That's when I will go back to this and start asking, what if? What if I was wrong about this part of the character? What if I should have, gone with a different era? What if the obstacles were different? What if I don't understand the consequences? So doing that helps me focus and narrow in on the story that I'm writing. How many of you have a schedule? Are we going to 11 or 11:15? 11:15. Perfect. Okay, I have an assignment for you now. Okay, either by yourself or with someone nearby, whatever you'd like to do. Some writers like to interact. Other writers like to look straight ahead and pretend there's no one around them. I can support both approaches. I want you to pick either a story idea up here or come up with one of your own and go through this process. Start with an idea. Come up with your genre. Work out some aspects of your protagonist. Come up with their problem, their goal, their obstacles. Play around with it. And see if you can come up with a great foundation for your plot and characters if you were writing that book. I'm going to give you some time to do it, and then we're going to share. So go forth. Plot. Characterization. Okay? Go.
I'm obviously just joking. I'm just like, oh. something that's very good.
Okay, we got just a few minutes, so I'm going to call you back up here. You're probably not done, and that's okay. This is meant to get you started, to help you practice applying these principles. One thing I'm going to throw in here that I probably should have sooner. Another obstacle that we often forget to think about are other characters. The other characters in your story can be hindrances or helps toward a character's, your main character's goal. Character. And we often forget that. So the way to make sure you are utilizing other characters in your books as both obstacles and helps toward your main character's goals is to do all of this for them as well. Your supporting characters also have ages, obviously. They are characters too, who have aspects to them and their personalities and their defining traits. But you also, with these other characters, need to do this, because those characters also have goals, and they also have problems that they're working toward. Generally speaking, your strongest protagonist and antagonist interaction will come when their goals and problems conflict. When your antagonist is working toward a goal that directly contradicts the goal of your protagonist, or at least in some way does, you're going to get strong interactions that way. It won't always work like that, but it's awesome when it does. If you've ever read or seen the movie, Les Miserables, that's my French accent, guys. One of the reasons the relationship between Valjean and Javert is so powerful is because they both have goals they are working actively toward and completely and totally are dedicated to achieving, but only one of them can achieve it in the end. They can't both reach their goals. So that becomes a consequence for those guys. So do this for your supporting characters as well. Find out who they are, what they want, what's getting in the way, and what are the consequences of them not reaching their goals. As you do that, you build a deep and varied and layered cast, and they start to interact with each other's goals. And that adds strength to your plot. Okay, so should mention that sooner, but I forget stuff. It's okay. All right, so bear that in mind as you move forward. Now, who has a story, a plot foundation they've developed that they would like to share with us?
So mine is something that was like an idea seed that I write down on my phone. So I
perfect.
So it's like a dystopian alternate universe on like the very worst that can happen with Trump as president.
Okay.
So like machines replace a lot of jobs, we're cut off from all other countries, there's like walls between us and other countries, so a lot of people are unemployed, people who are, you know, different races or like lesbian, gay, are having to like run and hide who they love.
Is it going dystopian?
Yes.
If we lived in a dystopian society,
yes.
And there were lots of these kinds of problems.
So we decided to like have our protagonist be a male is like the protagonist, but like he's among a group of teenagers who are deciding to assassinate
the president
because
okay.
He like basically he's become a dictator like Hitler,
okay.
And there's no more.
So your protagonist
like
is a teenager.
Election. There's
okay.
No more presidential elections. Like he's just
okay. That would be bad.
Over.
Yes.
So they have decided to assassinate him to try and fix
okay.
The world.
So that's their goal. You have your main character, a teenager, as part of a bigger group of teenagers looking to overthrow a tyrannical government in a society that has fallen apart. Okay. And so it gets in the way.
Definitely security.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's right, yeah, but that's what you're starting to think through, right? And the consequences, if they fail, they probably die, right? If they succeed, then maybe this dystopian society can rebuild and better. So as you work through this and work out your obstacles, this is kind of your plot and where you're at least your basic of it. You can take classes about how to actually outline a very specific plot. This is your foundation. So yeah, so dystopia, but your main character is a teenager working against the dystopian government. So there are going to be extra difficulties with your protagonist being a teenager? Absolutely.
So you bear in mind where they are developmentally, the kind of things they're capable of doing. It would all be very different if it were like an 80-year-old trying to throw over to the government. And you're like, no, wait, slow down. I walk like that, guys. No, seriously. There are mornings when I'm like, 100. Okay, who else has one they could throw out for us? Yeah.
I'm not trying to follow your format here, so okay. My idea was just that I was kind of going off with the never made a difference. I was going to get this kid who succeeds, and I want my audience to be young adult.
Okay, perfect. So it's a kid who never succeeded anything.
Yeah, and his family's like super genius, and he's got like his genius older brother who's like working for the government, and he's like super awesome.
So his brother is this 18-year-old genius hacker,
yeah. Yeah, and then we kind of introduce a problem here where his brother is on an airplane, and the airplane disappears. And no one can find out where it is, but this brother, he's actually a genius, but he'll be a no because of his family, and they're way smart or something. So
he's still ridiculously smart, but he's just in this family.
So he actually figures out what happens, and he has some kind of lead, but nobody believes him.
So that's your obstacle.
He's never failed before, basically, in comparison to his family. So that's kind of this family obstacle.
I'd read that book today.
It'd be, you know, like, it's some huge government plot sort of thing or something. Oh,
so you have both the loss of his brother, huge government plot he's trying to, or is accidentally uncovering, and so maybe the government's coming up. Right. So many obstacles, so many consequences.
I would still read that.
Right? Yeah. And all it started out with was this seed. Never felt like it made a difference. You kind of twisted it a little bit to never was the success, never lived up to the hype. So you see how that's a great basis for a story. If you jump from there, you're miles ahead of where you were before. I would totally read that book. So if you ever write it, I expect to receive a copy. But I would read that book. That's awesome.
Copyright.
Copyright. All right, I think we've got time for one more.
I came up with a story about a girl who is a changeling, meaning that she was taken by a fairy as an infant.
So
she's trying to return to the mortal world to find her parents.
Okay, so we're probably looking at fantasy or magical
realism.
She never
knew her father. In there.
Never knew her father. Okay, awesome. Okay, and is she grown up now?
She's only 16. She's just reached the age where she would be returned to the mortal world. Except that no changeling has been taken for 2,000 years, and she's learned magic, and they're afraid to return her. She might.
So that's why in this case, 16 is a... That aspect of her character is super important because there's something attached, there's a milestone attached to that age. So her goal is it to decide to go back or to try to go back?
Her goal is to go back and find her parents.
Okay, and so the obstacles?
The obstacles are the fae who are trying to stop her, the fact that she doesn't know how to find her parents when she gets to the mortal world, and also the fact she really knows nothing about the mortal world. She's never been there since she was 2 days old.
Okay, so what are some of the consequences? What's the consequence if she succeeds?
The consequences, she'll be able to have a family.
Okay. Will there be consequences for the fairy world if she succeeds? Will it hurt the people she knew before?
They think that if she shows the world magic that the humans will find out about the fae and destroy them. So but she thinks she can hide the magic and no one will just know.
So the possibility of particular consequences still works because that's still tension, that's still conflict. And if she fails?
If she fails, she'll be trapped in the fairy world forever, and she'll never go back. She'll never be able to compete with other mortals.
So you see how that's a great foundation for a plot for characters. You build from there. This is a great way to start writing a story. It's a great way to fix a story that's gone off the rails. It's a great way to explore a seed idea to determine if it's worth exploring, because you're going to have a million ideas, and you don't want to spend time on one that's not going to work. So take this idea, practice with it, change it up to find what works for you. Go forth, write, enjoy the end.